Good morning. So good to see all of you here, especially the Scheidelman's family and Cody and Christian, who are here eagerly. They were so excited when we had this little brief run through a couple of days ago. And it was so exciting to see that somebody's going to be baptized. I hope that, you know, when I see those excited children or excited people, kind of lifts me up, saying that, you know, I need to be more excited about my faith as well. You know, these are young people who are going to grow up and be God's men in this world to come. And it's important that we support them, we support being with them, and it's important that we support their families and all the support system these young children have with them. And we will, our scripture story fits right into it when Jesus was a 12-year-old boy. And it fits right into it and how he grew into wisdom and stature. So it's a wonderful Sunday for us to be here in the presence of God. And I want to welcome all of you who are here with us in person and those of you who are joining us on Facebook Live, that this service is coming to you from the First United Methodist Church of East Greenbush. I'm Pastor Sundar. I want to welcome all of you. Stay with us and listen to the music, join the music, singing one more time that we sang those hymns which we so love, and be in worship together. 1 hour is not a big part of your life, but it's a huge difference maker in your life that you spend time in God's presence. So I hope that you'll stay with us and be part of it. We'll invite Gene Cheviak, our worship leader. We'll come and do welcome.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to add my welcome to that of Pastor Sundar, to all of you here in the sanctuary, as well as those of you who are watching on Facebook, and who will be watching the recordings that will be posted later today. The beautiful poinsettias on our altar are now available for those of you who ordered them. You can pick them up after the service or come in during the week to get them. And we have a couple of other announcements. If you haven't yet been one of the 350 viewers of Cookies and Carols on Facebook and YouTube, make sure to do that. It's after the craziness of Christmas right now. Take a little quiet time and listen to the music and listen to the readings on that. It's really very nice. You'll find it on the church Facebook page and the church YouTube page. Also, remember, pick up your offering envelopes if you haven't already done so. They're out by the door on your way out. And we have one more announcement from George.
Good morning, all, and welcome to those of you who are out in the land of television and whatnot, or wherever. Internet, what is it? Internet, I guess it is. Hey, old men screw up sometimes. We have a tradition here in our church, and that is when there's a baptism, we have a book to sign. This day, we have two books to sign. So make sure you sign two books. These books will be given to the families of the two young people being baptized this morning, and we hope that you will leave a little message for them. You can write your name any place in the book. You don't have to write it on the flip pages, as some folks already have. But please do don't sit and read them now. You know, you can read them later. I'll give you a copy you can look at if you want to. But make sure we get it passed around so everybody can see it. So I'm going to bring these down and ask people and everybody. Kids, I don't care who it is, everybody's welcome to sign. Thank you.
While George is passing that around, why don't we turn to page 234, which is, O Come All Ye Faithful. And that's going to be the choir that's going to be singing it, and you can follow along. And I do think here it says, if I read it correctly, refrain only, that we do the refrain. So we listen to it and join in on the refrain. Thank you.
Just do the refrain. Just do the refrain.
Okay, now, welcome again, and somehow I messed that up, so I apologize, but will you stand and join me for the call to worship? God's love has come to earth to dwell with us. We are God's chosen people, loved and cherished. The birth of love has changed us forever. Let us sing, praise, rejoice, and worship together. Now, the opening hymn is number 250, Once in Royal David City. So we'll join together singing that, and after, for those who can stand, we will do the opening prayer.
Thank you.
Even as we celebrate the love that was born on Christmas, we know that your love continues to grow far beyond Christmas Day. Even as parents watch tenderly and proudly as their children grow into adulthood, you hold us in your compassionate embrace throughout our lives. Guide us into mature faith, O God, that we may love Jesus in our love, in our humility and wisdom, and in every word and deed. Shape us, inspire us, challenge us, and bless us with the music. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
This is a wonderful time. We are truly blessed by the Capital Area Council of Churches Ecumenical Witness. It completes our family. You know, when Jesus asked all of us to become the body of Christ, it really, really completes our family. Here is represented by Dave and Jean Karcher from from Cathedral of All Saints, and Kit Jackson of Altamont Reformed Church. You do bring joy to us, and you are here to bless us, and we are deeply blessed and grateful to God and grateful for your time here with us, and we want to welcome you to our sanctuary, our church, and you're no strangers. You've been here a lot more times than a lot of our own members at times, but it's wonderful to see you here and be in this special time, share this special moment with us. So I invite Christian and Cody to bring their family members. Please do. Just hold on. Just as I'm told. It's all right, they can do that. Baptism is such a pivotal point in anyone's life, in a family's life or a young person's life. It reminds us of our own Lord's baptism, which is quite different, but, you know, kind of he set the stage for all of us to come, identify with the church and be followers of Christ. So this morning we are grateful to God for both, you know, Christian and Cody, who are here to be baptized. And brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price.
I present for baptism Christian Alexander Scheidelman and Cody Thomas Scheidelman.
Friends, you bring Christian and Cody for baptism out of your faith, out of your hope, that they will know God's love and be part of the Christian community. So I'm asking all of you then to affirm your faith. Do you believe in God and in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord? Do you trust in God's grace for you and for Christian and Cody, who you bring for baptism today? In your faith, do you confess your sin and accept God's forgiveness? Will you ask to live before Christian and Cody as children of God yourselves and as disciples of Jesus Christ, and by your teaching and example, guide them to accept God's grace for themselves and to profess their faith openly and to lead a Christian life? To all of you, brothers and sisters, do you as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment of Christ? Will you continue to nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include Christian and Cody and their family in your nurture and care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Christian and Cody and their family with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life.
At this time, I will ask the Capital Area Council of Churches to offer a blessing. Thank you. With that declaration and that sense offering of love and community, God of love, we give thanks for your gift of life-giving water. Your Spirit hovered over the waters of creation and brought forth order and life. Pour out your Spirit on this gift of water and those who receive it, that they may know the gift of life in your name. Wash them clean, and in your forgiving love, keep them close to you all their lives, clothed in your righteousness. We ask these things in the name of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Christian, come on over. Christian, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Cody, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And both of you, Cody, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through the water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. And Christian, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through the water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Now it is our joy to welcome Christian and Cody as baptized members of the family of Christ. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you, Christian and Cody, and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace for your entire life. Amen. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you.
Here. These are baptism candles.
We come now to our time of scripture, and we'll read this morning from St. Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 51, and I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. Each year, his parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to their custom. After the festival was over, they were returning home, but the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents didn't know it. Supposing that he was among their band of travelers, they journeyed on for a full day while looking for him among their family and friends. When they didn't find Jesus, they returned to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple. He was sitting among the teachers, listening to them and putting questions to them. Everyone who heard him was amazed by his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were shocked. His mother said, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Listen, your father and I have been worried. We've been looking for you." Jesus replied, "Why were you looking for me? Didn't you know that it was necessary for me to be in my father's house?" But they didn't understand what he said to them. Jesus went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. His mother cherished every word in her heart. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second hymn this morning is number 240, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Please stand if you are able.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Want to thank the family for Christian and Cody for their support here for them. And I know for sure that with God's grace that they will raise these two young men, two boys, to be mature men and women of God. In a story that even Jesus grew up in stature, in wisdom. And it's important to see that part of it, how much Jesus identified with humanity. He had it everything. He had it all. Before the foundations were laid, he was God himself, God in essence and God in everything. Yet he came down to us, to our level, to our humanity, to identify with us so that we can be lifted up into God's presence. It's such a wonderful story to have, to look forward to, that each one of us are a child in so many ways. We might, you know, chronologically, we might have retired, we might have doing other things, but before God, we are all children of God, yet to learn more about Jesus and to grow in him. Luke is the only gospel writer who gives us a peek into the childhood of Jesus. Luke, the physician, is analytical and an observer of life. Biblical historians believe that Luke had much of his research with first-hand observers of life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Not being an apostle, having first-person knowledge, he relied upon others. One of those was Mary, the mother of Jesus. And he had authentic person from the beginning. From the beginning to the end to the resurrection. So nobody could dispute that Luke made it up. His mother was there. And he gave her a hard time at times. Just like any other child. But the mother's love was there for him and nurtured him and helped him to grow into the likeness of God. Someone said that Jesus' childhood is like a walled garden, the inside of which no one has seen. Luke plucked one flower from inside of that garden and gave it to us to read and to contemplate. We have been doing that for 2,000 years, the richness of who Jesus is. None of us can, you know all about Jesus in an entire lifetime, even in eternity. We are given a glimpse of who Jesus is and how great his love for us has been from the beginning of the time. So it's important to see that part of it. Let's examine the background of his scripture passage. We read that the nuclear family of Joseph, Mary, and Jesus traveled to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover festival. Jewish rabbinical law required every male to go to 3 annual festivals a year in Jerusalem. When that was established, it was much easier for men to attend. But time and distance has eroded that possibility. The Jews were now scattered over many miles in the Roman Empire, so that most attended only one of the festivals a year. The festival that the family attended traditionally was the Passover feast festival. Why it's so important, Passover? The festival was a 7-day event, celebrating the deliverance that God gave to the Israelites when Moses led them out of Egypt. The Passover was the 10th plague. Moses was told that the blood of a lamb was to be placed on the doorposts of the house of the land, and the angel would pass over them, and their firstborn would be alive. It is to this last plague that finally convinced Pharaoh to allow the Israelites to leave Egypt. They would continue to celebrate this festival of the Exodus from slavery until this very day. It is so important for us. The identity of the people began there when they left Egypt. When they left from that bondage, from slavery, they became people. God has called them long time ago to the people of God so that they can shine the light on all the nations. Abraham was given a covenant. Abraham was given a blessing, said, I will bless you so that you can be a blessing to other nations. You can be a blessing to the entire humanity. Luke told us that Jesus was 12 years old. This story occurred 1 year before Jesus' bar mitzvah. Now, according to Jewish law, a Jewish boy becomes an adult at age 13. That means he becomes accountable for his own actions are obligated to the ritual responsibilities of Jewish life. In the Methodist Church, we call it as confirmation, that they go through classes for a year, understanding their church theology, the divinity of Christ, and a whole bunch of other stuff. For a year, they will take classes, and they will visit different places of worship, knowing, understanding other people's faith as well, while being grounded in their own faith. And the fun thing was that before the pandemic, we took them to New York City to see the oldest United Methodist Church in our nation. This church was born before the independence. And it's still there, and its people still worship there, and a lot of artifacts there. And kids always had so much fun in New York City, George being our leader. You know, with fear and trembling, we got into the trains and got, you know, into other train and, you know, without losing anybody. So we managed, but it was fun to be with them and to show them their tradition, their history, the church's history of the Methodist Church here. And it's important to see that part of it. So that means that when Jesus became 13, he became accountable for his own actions, obligated to the ritual responsibilities of Jewish life. And we discover through our reading that Jesus is already preparing himself for that, for this important event in his life. At 12, he was in the temple arguing and listening to, questioning people, beginning to learn his faith, this Torah. When he is the temple listening and asking the questions, religious scholars. So the question for us this morning is that, what can we learn from today's scripture passage? How is that important to us? We must be extremely cautious not to miss Jesus. And it's important to see that part of it. I'll come to that. Festival is over. Our Christmas celebrations is over. The family is headed home to Nazareth. Our children and others who visited us, they are probably making plans to go home. But they are not a threesome like we would do things today. The Jews of that time lived in extended families. For any travel to festival, they walked together as a whole caravan of people, friends and family, people separately. Usually the younger children would walk with moms at the front of the caravan. The older children could go either direction between the two groups. The kids belonged to the whole group of people. Everybody looked after the kids. Nobody got lost. People were together. This lessened the threat from thieves and other dangerous situations along the road. This also gave them time for fellowship. They gathered together, the 12-year-olds and 13-year-olds and 15-year-olds all gathered, talked about each other and doing all kinds of things. It's important to see that part of it. As one commentator writes, the caravan could be joined by other groups of travelers from neighboring towns to form a great many people moving from foothills to the deserts of the area. Many thought Jesus was with Joseph. Mary thought Jesus was with Joseph. While Joseph thought Jesus was with Mary. So when they stopped for the first night on the way back, they met together as a family. Mary was the first one to ask, "Where is Jesus, honey?" And of course, Joseph replied as a typical husband's answer, "Isn't he with you, dear? I thought you had him." A frantic search began, and they found that no one had seen him since they left that morning. 46 states that they looked for Jesus for 3 days. And I think this is how it went. It seems more logical to assume that it took one day for them to journey away from Jerusalem, one day to return to the city back when they didn't find him in the group where they camped out, and one day to search for the boy in Jerusalem. So that makes it 3 days. He was not lost for 3 days. It took them one day to get there, one day to get back, and one day to search. And these parents, you know, 12-year-old, did he really go to church? Did he really go to the temple? Temple was locked, and you know, you couldn't just walk in like a church building. They had rules and regulations and do a lot of other good things. So apparently they looked for all the places a 12-year-old would want to go. I don't think they ever imagined that he would be sitting there amazingly dazzling people who are like 100 years old in the scripture and Torah, and teaching them and learning from them. It was not something which, you know, any 12-year-old would do. It was so different. And these, you know, it's important to see that part of it. These parents didn't abandon Jesus for 3 days. It was an unfortunate mistake, but they absolutely loved their son. They absolutely loved their son. The Daily Guidepost for December 29, 2013 told that this story. Phil and Kate, who had 3 children of their own, decided to adopt a little girl who had been abandoned on the streets of China. The grandmother, Brenda Wilbur, was writing the devotional for the day, and she said that before getting their adopted daughter, they learned that she had osteogenesis imperfect, a brittle bone disease. And people, some of us know what it means. You know, I had a church member in Bainbridge, you know, her 2 boys always had these problems, and it was really, really hurtful, really, really heartbreaking to see these young boys. They could do little activity, and then out of the blue, they were in a cast or doing something. So Brenda asked her son what they were going to do about this situation. With despair in his voice, the son shared, I can't abandon her now. So the 2-year-old was adopted. Several of her bones have since broken. Surgeries have been a way of life for the 2-year-old Alice. Phil's mom wrote, I went to help the day of one of her surgeries. Evidence of Phil and Kate's sacrifice for Alice was everywhere. Having given up their spacious 2-story home, 6 people were jammed into a small fixer-upper. No privacy, no individual space, no place to put their toys or boats. They didn't seem to notice. On that visit, her grandson, Jamie, age 7, led her to where Alice lay on her mattress, leg splint and waiting to travel to the hospital for surgery. The little girl gave a pain-laced smile to Brendan and Jamie. Alice and Jamie touched noses. Jamie said in a quivering voice, it's so sad that she's so breakable. What's not sad is, Granny, that she is such a cute face. Don't you think that she has a cute face, Granny? So the boy, in spite of the hurt, was looking at the positive aspect of it. Brenda wrote that she agreed with Jamie and that my heart was bursting with love for this joyous, happy child and overflowing with gratitude. For her, parents unwilling to abandon her. Jesus may have been out of sight for a while for his parents, but never out of their hearts. They did everything to find him. You know, yes, Christmas Eve, we had services, we were exhausted. Our daughter came 2 o'clock, 2:30, and we celebrated a quick Christmas Eve dinner and exchanged presents, and you know, she was supposed to come to church, but she had some issues with the kids, so she took them home. So we were here in the service, and I waited and looked at and said, I can take a long break. And I forgot that Sunday was the next door. I completely forgot. Well, I had 2 services and a Holy Communion. What more can I do? You know, this is week, and I have a whole week to go rest and recover. I said, no, Sunday is the day after tomorrow. And I forgot to get the notes out of my computer, written notes. I usually print it. And I forgot that part of it too. So I came Saturday, spent a couple hours in the office, printing my notes, and guess what? My computer had suddenly developed pneumonia and then had all kinds of characters on it, right over my notes. And I said, oh gosh, no, please, please, don't let anything happen to this computer. So I turned it off, walked around the building. There was nobody in this building. Walked around the building for 5 minutes and came back and turned it on. The notes came back. And I quickly pressed, saying they printed. And I heard the printer go on. I said, oh, thank God, notes are printed. But, you know, the thing is that during that time, after the service and other stuff, Jesus was missing in my life. You know, you did the service, and, you know, here was the Mary and Joseph. We sang, and Christmas Eve service, we celebrated presents and all. okay. But I think it was important. It was an awakening, a wake-up call for me. To where is Jesus in your life today, at this moment, when you're running around and doing these things? And I kind of wondered about it. Are you missing Jesus in your life? Just like Mary and Joseph did. And what did they do? They went looking for him. Abandon all else until you find Jesus. It's important to see this part of it, that so many times we put our lives on the treadmill of urgent. Urgently we want to do this, urgently we want to do that. And there's even families, urgently we want to go right through and get McDonald's meals, and everybody got their meal, okay, we have done. But the important part of it is that if we sit down and eat a meal together with our children, you see a world of difference in their lives and in your own life. And my wife just started a new tradition saying, so what was the best memories you have for Christmas? So we went back to start over from Cortland on to Bainbridge and Cooperstown and here. What were some of the wonderful memories you had which included Christmas in your life? There were some wonderful stories we shared and some of those funny stories we shared with our kids and with ourselves. And I can't wait for her to begin another tradition next year. But it's important to see that who Christ is. And if you can't find him, you know where he is? He's at the edge of your heart waiting to come in today. If you feel that Jesus is missing in your life, he's not way out somewhere in the outer space. He's there at the edge of your heart waiting to come in today. And Jesus in Revelation 3:20 says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and have supper with them. Doesn't say I will come in and scold you. It doesn't say I will come and yank your hair. It doesn't say I will come and sup with him. It's so important that even God is willing to sit down at the table with us so that we know that he is there for us. We don't miss him. If Jesus is missing in your life, look for him. Abandon all else. First, look for him. We must be careful to look and find Jesus. Now, after returning to Jerusalem, those parents looked frantically, asking anybody and everybody who would listen if they had seen their son Jesus. That is our goal, frantically looking for Jesus. He's our only hope and he's our only joy. He's our only one who gives us peace. Seeking Jesus into 2020 is such an important aspect of it. We are worried about pandemics. We are worried about this and that, and all rightly so, for good reasons. But I think, don't let us forget where Jesus is. How do I seek God? By seeking calmness and serenity. Where lives are hectic, filled with so many activities. We live in a chaotic and frightening world full of violence and marred by turmoil and conflict. Daily we see the aftermath of hatred and racism and terror. It would be easy for us to hide from it and fret over it, but be on a constant state of fear. Only God can bring a peaceful, calm, and clear view. When everything around is swirling out of control, the prophet Isaiah stated it precisely. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Apostle John writes, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. By seeking purity of desire and heart, the beat of our heart to be like Jesus, we need to allow his Holy Spirit to fill us and his love to overwhelm us, to want to act like Jesus. Live as close to Jesus as possible. Seek his heart's desire for ourselves. By seeking a spirit of cheerfulness and positive outlook, listen to what God's word says to us. Apostle Paul writes in Philippians 4:8, finally, siblings, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Proverbs 4:6 says, do not forsake wisdom, for she will protect you and love her, and she will watch over you. Prophet Jeremiah 29:11, he says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. And Matthew says in 14:27, be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. By seeking a life of prayer, Richard Baxter, who lived in the 1600s, wrote this: prayer must continue our work as much as preaching. He preached not heartily to his people, he said, that will not pray for them. Prayer must precede all that ministers and laypersons do in church. That includes teaching, serving on boards and committees, sharing good news of God's care, giving and more. And how do I find Jesus? It is simple. Ask him to come into your life. Confess your need of him, that your heavy-hearted life is more than you can manage. Thank him for his willingness to forgive you and your shortcomings. Serve him with your whole heart. We must be careful to live an obedient life. You know, many of us are like this story I read, the little boy who was confined for a time at a children's hospital many years ago. The child has gained a reputation for breaking havoc with the staff and nurses. So one day a visitor who knew about his terrorizing nature made him a deal. He said, Charlie, if you're good for a week, she said, I'll give you a dime when I come home. Come again. A week later, she stood before his bed. I'll tell you what I want to ask the staff or the nurses if you behaved. You must tell yourselves, do you deserve a dime? So after a moment's pause, a small voice under the cover said, please, give me a penny. We compartmentalize our life. Religion is for Sunday. What we do with the rest of the week is ours. It's our words, our actions, our money, and our fill in your blanks yourself. The truth is that every compartment of our lives is Christ's. Every word that comes out of us should be Christ's. Every action we take should be Christ's. As John the Baptist said, when he looked at Jesus, he must increase and I must decrease. Always, Jesus must excel in my life and I, my own attitude, must decrease. Jesus said, anyone who loves me will obey my teachings. My Father will love them and we will come to them and make our home with them. We must be fully committed to obeying Jesus. James 1:22 says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Mother Teresa, I love this one. Mother Teresa of Calcutta once said, be faithful in the little practices of love, which will build in you the life of holiness and make you Christ-like. You want to be Christ-like? Little practices of love. Didn't say fantastic actions, fantastic this. Little practices of life which will build you in the life of holiness and make you Christ-like. Hang on to the principles we were taught by Jesus and his family today. Remember the essence of Christian living or Christian holiness, as John Wesley said, I'll finish this with, is simplicity and purity. One design and one desire. Entire devotion to God. Is simplicity and purity, one design, one desire, entire devotion to God. Let us pray. Almighty and living God, we thank you for the year which has gone by almost. We're looking forward to 2022. We pray that you would guide our thoughts, guide our actions, help us to be more Christ-like in all that we say and do. Forgive us for the mistakes we have made, for not loving you with all our hearts and not loving our neighbor as ourselves. Send us forth from here in the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Before the light, the stars grew dim, and wandering hunters heard the hymn. Jesus, your King is born. Jesus is born in Czech's glory. Within a lodge of broken bark, the tender babe was found. A ragged robe of rabbit skin enwrapped his beauty round. But as the hunter braves drew nigh, the angel song rang loud and high. Jesus, your King is born. Jesus is born in excelsis glory. The earliest moon of winter time is not so round and fair as was the ring of glory on the helpless infant there. The chiefs from far before him knelt with gifts of fox and beaver pelt. Jesus, your King is born. Jesus is born in excelsis glory. Oh, children of the forest free, oh, seed of Manitou, the holy child of earth and heaven is born today for you. Come kneel before the radiant boy who brings you beauty, peace, and joy. Jesus, your King is born. Jesus is born in excelsis glory.
Thanksgiving. God of miracles, when Jesus was born, angels, shepherds, sages, and even animals rejoiced and gave thanks. Today, we delight in our chance to join the Christmas party of gratitude. Thank you for naming us your beloved children. We offer you our hearts, our deeds, and our entire lives in thanksgiving for the gift of Christ Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
We come now to our time of sharing joys and concerns. And of course, the joy this morning of the baptisms is right in before us, which is really nice. And also, we have the joy of knowing that Deb Samuel's 91-year-old mother is recovering after a brain aneurysm only 3 months ago, so that's really good news. And we did hear about several birthdays this upcoming week, Mady Flowers and Kathy Van Buren on the 28th, and Chris Chartrand and Art Sanderson on the 31st, so lots of birthdays to celebrate in this holiday week. As always, there are many, many concerns that we pray for on our list. George has just brought to our attention two. T.J. Blau is on our prayer list, and Matthew Hempel, who is, as we speak, about to receive a double organ transplant. So we pray for both of those people. And also the family of Randolph Cox upon his recent death. He's a cousin of Patty Chartrand's. And we pray for Kara Sattler, Gail Bradley, the family and friends of Mary Wilkinson, who passed away, Carolyn and Joe Carpenter, the Peller family upon recent deaths in their family. We pray for safe travels for Gina. We pray for Sean Rivers, the family of Nancy Levy upon her recent death, for Tom Barnes, Kathy Roberts, Crystal Burns. We pray for Steve and Yolanda Botti, for Sequoia Britton, for Mary Ingram on the death of her daughter, Krista. We pray for Zelda Hoteling, Doug Hagen, for Drake, for Dory Hanlon on the death of her sister, for Denise Caridi, for Kirsten and from Jennifer Lacobi. We pray for hope and peace for all. We pray for John Hill, for Bruce Messig, for Georgia Hollingshead, Samuel Steinbach, Laura Moulton, Jerry and Shirley Dunn, Sandy Comrie, Betty Lennon. We pray for David Diedrich, for Paul Mosley and family on a mission trip, for Catherine Nardacci, for Karen Javinsky, for Xavier, Kenneth Jackson, Randy Vieli, Cecilia. We pray for Karen, who has received good news in regard to her cancer diagnosis, and Carmela. We pray for Rick Klimberg, Gwen Smith, Leah Buono, Sherry St. Louis, for Valerie Perrott's parents, for Tim Perrott, John Moore, Fred Van Ornum. We pray for Judy Davis, Sandy Cummings, Louise Wells, Stephen Burnett, Eric Subic, for Nellie Smith, for David Smith and daughter Sally, for Paul Smith and Claudia Emmerich. We pray for Richard Smith, the residents of Riverside, Rosewood, Eddy Heritage House, Van Rensselaer Manor, Peregrine Assisted Living, Collar City Nursing and Rehabilitation, and Hawthorne Ridge. We pray for all of these people, as well as those we hold in our hearts, as we sing together our call to prayer.
Almighty and ever-living God, we lift up all the names that are spoken and those in our hearts which are not spoken yet. We lift them up into your presence. We ask your blessing and healing. We ask you to open their eyes to your grace and love, and may they experience your love in a different way, even in very difficult circumstances. Be with them and guide them and their families. We pray for all those families who lost a loved one this past year. We ask your comfort, care for them as well. We pray for our men and women in uniform, those who stand up for us, those who defend us, and those who provide care for us in different places at different times. We lift up our voices to thank you for them, and we ask you to protect and preserve them and bring them home. Almighty and ever-living God, we pray for our nation. We are grateful to you for the gifts you have given to us. At the same time, we humble ourselves and ask your forgiveness that we have not loved you, nor our neighbor, with all our hearts. We have not provided for those who are less fortunate. We pray that you would forgive us and help us to do better. We pray for our president and the vice president and all those people who are in authority in the Congress, that you would hold their hands and you would guide them in the footsteps of Jesus, that they would be guided by you in their thoughts and words and in actions, that they would not be obligated to do those things which elected them, but they would be obligated to obey you and to follow you, O Lord. We pray for our world. There's so much of pain and anguish, so many towns and places shuttered down, loss of jobs and loss of hope in so many people. We pray that you would lift them up. We thank you for the doctors and the nurses and the scientists who are producing vaccine at such a record pace. We thank you for their knowledge. We thank you for their gift to all of us. We humble ourselves, O Lord, as the year ends, that you are a God who provided for us, kept us safe. And we pray that you'd continue to watch over us as we walk into 2022 in a short period of time. May we walk close to you. May we call you to rule our hearts and rule our thoughts and our words. Gracious and loving God, I thank you for each one who's here. Especially we lift up Christian and Cody. We ask your blessings upon them as they grow in the knowledge and love of Christ, that you would bless them with all the goodness, with all the gifts and graces, for them to learn about you and to be your men of God in this world. We thank you and praise you for them, O Lord. We offer this prayer in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our next carol at the closing is 251, Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Thank you.
Please join me in the benediction, which is a responsive reading. Let's pray together. You are God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. You have been called into the one body where the peace of Christ is the ruler. You live in the richness of Christ's word with wisdom and music all around. And whatever you do, or indeed, everything, go in Christ's peace to serve God and our neighbor. Amen.